Hello, this is Michael Beers, West Coast editor for Jam Magazine, and I'm here with Prairie Prince, drummer extraordinaire of The Tubes. Prairie, how are you, sir?
I'm very good today.
Great, great. So here you are, opening up The Tubes, that is, for the Hollywood Vampires. Now, you have, what, four or five dates in the UK?
Five dates in the UK, and that's it.
and then what about, are you going to the continent, going to Europe?
Yes, we have two shows in Germany, one in Bochum and one in Berlin.
Great, and after
we'll be doing our full show at those two shows.
And approximately how long are your full shows?
Well, about those two shows in Germany will be probably 2 hours, maybe an hour, 50 minutes. And this show that we're doing with the Vampires is only 50 minutes. So we're trying to cram in as much excitement as we can in those 50 minutes. We're trying to get a little bit of our theatrical things going. Quaalude comes out at the end, wraps up the show, but before that, Fee does his Mondo Bondage character. We got a kind of Frank Sinatra character like we used to have back in the day doing This Town, but today we're doing That's Life. And then we have the kind of game show guy, What Do You Want From Life, that kind of thing. So.
Great. And now, after Europe and everything, do you guys have any kind of U.S. tour, any kind of dates set up in the U.S.?
Yeah, directly from, actually not direct. I have three or four shows in August with The Tubes. We're opening for Rick Springfield. One of the shows, we're opening for Cheap Trick, one of the shows. Doing a couple solo shows for ourselves in Phoenix. And then we're doing some shows in October with Oingo Boingo. The remaining members of Oingo Boingo, it's almost like The Tubes. We only have three original members now. We lost Rick Anderson, our bass player, in late last year.
Speaking of Oingo Boingo, you guys, I mean, you had some, first of all, let's go before that. You opened for some of the greatest bands, from Led Zeppelin, David Bowie, Peter Gabriel, but you had some phenomenal bands open for you. Oingo Boingo, the Ramones, but also this unknown comic of Robin Williams.
That's right.
I understand that he actually got his gig, a big start, was like a audience contest that he came on stage and did the Hormone Blues. Do you remember that?
That, you know the story. It was called The Tubes Talent Hunt.
With Martin Mull hosting.
Martin Mull was the host. We had never really heard of Robin Williams. He had been a stand-up comedian in Marin County, who's just kind of starting his career off. And he came and auditioned for our talent hunt, and he sang a song called The Hormone Blues, where he has a very hairy man, and he just had on overalls, like suspenders with just hair all over him, and cowboy hat and some chaps or something like that, and he came out and sang Hormone Blues, and ended it by saying, I went to bed last night and I woke up with the hair on my chest, and I woke up the next morning with a couple of beautiful breasts. I'm changing.
Nice.
It's a transgender, early transgender remark.
Right. Another thing I'd like to ask you too. You worked with quite a few great people, but on the album Teaser by Tommy Bowman, you played drums on that, correct?
I played on the song The Wild Dogs and on the song Savannah Woman.
And Tommy Bowman played sort of a homage to you. There's a famous iconic poster of him performing at Winterland wearing one of your Tubes t-shirts that you designed.
That's right.
So did you have a good relationship with Tommy?
I mean, yeah.
Great. Would you mind just sharing just a little story anecdote, maybe something that just gives, because he's been gone for so long, but in lieu of the Hollywood Vampires, maybe he'd be a great person to talk about right now. If you could say, just share a little story with him, if you wouldn't mind.
Tommy Bowman was just one of my favorite guitar players, right? The first time I heard him, and my band with Roger Steen also, we were called the Red, White, and Blues Band. We opened for his band, which is, at that time he was playing with Zephyr. Who was a band from Colorado somewhere, I think, or I'm not sure. Yeah, I know he was from South Dakota, but I think Zephyr was based out of somewhere in Colorado, maybe Boulder. And both of our bands were opening for Jethro Tull on their first tour. It was 1968. Could have been 69, but I think it was 68. And we kind of fell in love with each other, talked to each other backstage. He said, I really love your band. And we said, we really love you. And he goes, And we said, well, you know, we're going to go out to the desert tonight. We had a thing where we would get a generator and go out to the Phoenix Desert, where we grew up in Phoenix, Arizona, and set up the generator and set up some equipment up on the boulder rocks and stuff. So he came with us, and we jammed all night long. I don't remember exactly what we jammed, but probably some Hendrix and some Cream and maybe just, some original stuff or just some blues. And that was it. Then I never really saw him or talked to him again. The Tubes got a record deal, and the engineer was the guy named Lee Kiefer. He was the engineer for Al Kooper, who was our first producer on our first album, 1975. So this was 8 years later, and I hadn't really followed Tommy's career much, like Deep Purple, all that stuff. Hadn't really followed it. But then became back associated with him, and the engineer, Lee, who had finished doing the Tubes album, called me and said, Tommy Bolin and I are working on his first solo album after Deep Purple. Would you come down to LA and play on it? So I did, and just locked tight again. He saw some of the shirts that we were painting at the time for the Tubes. He goes, I gotta have one of those shirts. So I painted him one like the one I was wearing. And then he called me back later. He goes, I'm doing a second album. I want you to do paint a face shirt for me. I want you to use the face that from the photograph on teaser. So I did that as well.
Wow, great. I understand also you were in another incredible project featuring Andy West of the Dixie Dregs in Buckethead.
That was called The Mistakes. I named the band because I said, someone said, well, what should we call it? And it was also Mike Keneally. And Henry Kaiser. So we were a quartet, and we just got together. I think it was a Henry Kaiser project, and he brought in Buckethead because he and Buckethead were friends. And it was just a recording project. We didn't plan to do any live shows or anything, but we got together and we just started making music together. And so Mike Keneally goes, what should we call it? And I went, as far as I can tell, it just sounds like a bunch of mistakes to me. Because really, we were just, jamming back and forth on stuff, and they had a bunch of strange drop D melodies and a lot of weird time change stuff, and it just sounded like a mess to me a lot of the time. So he goes, that great name, The Mistakes. So the record came out, and then we did two live shows. One in San Francisco at the Great American Music Hall, and one in Santa Cruz at a place called Palookaville. And so I have videos. I have actually VHSs of those two shows. I have the record. I don't think it's.
Would that be something we could see on YouTube?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I've tried to look it up, I think, but it's got to be out there somewhere. Maybe I should post it to you.
And now this is a question for a drummer. I think back in the day with your Yamaha drum kit, you used to have a double kick, and now you're to a single. Now, some of the greatest drummers were single kick guys. You think of John Bonham, Ian Paice, Charlie Watts. But then some of the other greater drummers, you think of Ginger Baker, Keith Moon, Mitch Mitchell, double kick. So my question to you as a drummer, is like having a double kick, does it lend itself to a certain genre of music, or is it like incorporating style with technique, or what would you say the distinction between having a single kick and a double kick drum?
Well, I was a big fan of Ringo. He didn't have a double kick, but then when I saw Ginger Baker, he had a double kick. But also even before that, Louis Belson used to have double bass drums in the jazz world. And I always liked his drumming, and I thought, wow, it's so exciting, And I became a big Ginger Baker fan, and Mitch Mitchell as well. Mitch Mitchell was definitely one of my favorite drummers.
Nice. Well, hey, Prairie, I want to say thank you for your time.
Sure.
But I'd be remiss in one thing if I can ask. Sure. You do one of the best impersonations of Robert Mitchum. Can you give us our Bob Mitchum look?
Thank you very much,
Prairie. Thank you so much. Hey, you rock, and we wish you continued success and all the best to you and the Tube, sir.
Thank you so
very much.
Jam Magazine.
All right, thank you.